Good evening and welcome to Christ our Savior. May God richly bless us as we worship him this Good Friday. We will begin our service by singing, O Sacred Head Now Wounded. A soloist will sing the first verse. Please join in for the rest.
O sacred head now wounded, with grief and shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded, with thorns thy only crown. O sacred head, what glory, what bliss till now was thine. Yet though despised when gory, I joy to call thee mine.
Stand. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.
By his holy cross he has redeemed the world.
Remember his words, for they are light. Remember his works,
for they are our righteousness.
Remember his grace,
for it is ours to receive.
Remember his glory,
for it is the brilliance of God.
Remember his pain,
for it was not deserved.
Remember his sorrow,
for it was our hardness of heart.
Remember his life,
for it was perfect before God.
Remember his death,
for it was ours.
Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world.
By his holy cross, he has redeemed the world.
Please be seated. Our reading this evening comes from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 3 through 12. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and who can speak of his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of the Lord. We sing the hymn, "Now From Your Cheeks Has Vanished."
God's grace, mercy, and peace are yours in his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Word of God, I'd like to make a few comments on tonight before we enter into the tenebrae portion of our service, is Matthew 27, verse 22, which reads like this. What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ? Pilate asked. They all answered, Crucify him. Let's pray. O Lord, open my mouth, that my lips would speak your truth, that we would know what to do with Jesus. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, Good Friday today makes every individual ask with Pontius Pilate, What then shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Christ? There's no escaping it. Today is not like the other Jesus days we celebrate on the calendar, Christmas and Easter. You can celebrate those without him. There are plenty of family gatherings and fun traditions to memorably mark those days without having to deal with the one they're about. But not Good Friday. Everyone on some level, in some way, has to deal with Jesus today. Pontius Pilate had to. He first tried by avoiding Jesus, telling the Sanhedrin to do with him what they wanted. But that was against Roman law. Only Pontius Pilate had the authority to sentence someone to death and see the sentence carried out in that moment. He didn't stop there, though. He questioned Jesus. He tried to pawn Jesus off on Herod. He had him roughed up. He tried to exchange prisoners. He even washed his hands of him, but Jesus just wouldn't go away. Exasperated, Pilate asked the crowd, What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ? The gathered crowd knew what to do. Crucify him, they said. They had made their decision. When Pilate protested and said, Why? He's innocent. They said, Let his blood be on us and our children. At the urging of others, they decided to hate Jesus, even if it was for no good reason. Made no difference that many of them had cheered him on Palm Sunday. Today, what they wanted to do with him is see him die. Good Friday, in some way, shape, or form, makes everybody have to ask what Pilate asked. What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ? Hate him? Some people do. You know that. You often know it's for no good reason. Usually because someone told them something about him or something about those who profess faith in him. And they've made up their mind. And there seems to be nothing you can say to change it. You know, people who blame Jesus for everything bad in their life and everything wrong in the world. And again, there's nothing you can say to change it. Makes no difference whether it's true or not. They've made up their mind. To hell with him. They think, just like those on the first Good Friday thought. What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ? I don't think any of you here think you ought to hate him. But I imagine more than a few of us think we should feel sorry for him tonight. Maybe we're fixing to muster up a couple tears a little bit later in the service during the darkness. But you should be reminded of what Jesus said in the Gospel of Luke about crying on Good Friday. He said, don't be crying over me and my death. You should be crying over your own sins. What should we do with Jesus? You know that many try to ignore him. Act as if today is just another day. But like I said, it's pretty hard to do on Good Friday. The only Friday on the calendar called good. The only day on our calendar that has as its explanation, Jesus was crucified on it. There's no other explanation for this day. That's the only answer as to why there are all these cars at that Lutheran church at 7:45 at night. And why some people didn't come back after lunch today at work. Well, that's right. It's Good Friday. I forgot. And that realization, even that, is dealing with Jesus on Good Friday by trying to simply act as if it's no big deal. When you and I hear Jesus say from his cross in a few moments, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing, we may be tempted to think of only those people who choose to ignore him this day, who hate him, who dither or dismiss or are indifferent about him. But to do so, to think that, when Jesus says to forgive those who don't know what they're doing, is a sorry and sinfully self-righteous answer to Pilate's perpetual question. This day, Good Friday, makes every individual, Christian and non-Christian alike, you and me, ask, what are we going to do with him? You can love him, you can hate him. You can dismiss him, you can try to ignore him. You can diss him. But you can't escape some consideration of him today. Throughout his trial, Jesus answered many of the questions Pilate asked him. But he didn't ask this one. What am I supposed to do with you? He just stood there. Beaten and bloody already from the scourges that he endured, from the blows of the soldiers, from the crown of thorns. He just stood there in front of him and the crowd crying for his death, suffering already because of what the high priest and Pontius Pilate and the Sanhedrin and sinners like you and me do to him again and again to this very day. He just stood there and took it. What shall I do then with Jesus, this Jesus who is the Christ? If you don't know, let me just be blunt. Repent of your sins. Believe that what was done to Jesus this day, he took willingly in order to forgive you. Repent of those sins and believe that he died for them to take their guilt away and to give you a life that's high and holy now in God's eyes, one that's new, and you can follow Jesus into this life and serve him and others to his glory as you await the eternal crown of victory he won for you this day by having all that stuff done to him. So it wouldn't be done to you. That's what Jesus would have you do with him on Good Friday. And every day. Amen. Now may the peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. This time we'll gather our gifts and offerings, and also we'll pass the friendship registers. We do that especially for our guests and visitors. We'd love to follow up on you and either answer your questions or invite you to come back. So if you want to leave an email address as well as your name or some way to contact us, Vicar who will contact you will appreciate that. So let's pass the friendship registers and as well as gather our gifts and offerings, and then we'll explain how the tenebrae service will proceed. A few words of explanation before we get started so you know what's coming if you've never been to our Tenebrae service. You can see in the bulletin on the third and fourth panels a basic outline. We'll hear some commentary and then the actual word that Jesus spoke from the cross, and then that'll be followed immediately by a candle going out and the lights getting a little dimmer each time this happens. And then in between the words will be some music, and you can kind of see how that's all laid out. Different people will be doing different things for that. As we go, though, it will get dark in here. And if you need to step out, if you've got a restless child or something, that's fine. The lights are on down the hallway in some of the rooms, as well as the lights should be on, the lower lights in my office. If you need to sit on my couch, that's as fine as well. But it will get completely dark in here by the end of the seventh word. The choir will sing a final song, and then there's the strepitus, which is Latin for jarringly loud noise. And it's supposed to symbolize the closing of the tomb, but it's something of a tradition here that it's pretty loud. So I just warn you ahead of time. That sound signals the formal end of the worship service. The doors will open, just a little bit of light will come up out there, but you're welcome to stay in here as long as you'd like. But we would ask that you would leave tonight, though, without visiting, without talking. Just leave in reverent silence. If you want to visit and catch up with people, maybe in the parking lot, but not by the door here in the building. We just want to kind of keep the mood that it is. And then we gather, of course, on Easter in an entirely different spirit. So let us begin. The first word, Had Jesus been an ordinary prisoner, he would not have died that day. It was customary, even in that day and age, to show enough mercy upon a condemned criminal to give him time to prepare for his death. Jesus of Nazareth, Son of Man and Son of God, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, despised of the children of men, captured at midnight on Thursday, before 9 o'clock on Friday morning, is led out to Calvary to die. So bitterly are they opposed to him, so vehemently do they hate him, so grimly are they determined that he must be put out of the way. He is by this time a pitiful, almost gruesome caricature of a man. Portions of his body have been beaten to a pulpy mass. His back is red and torn by the lashes of the scourge, and his robe is wet with blood. The noble features are defaced by the unrelenting blows of many fists. The eyes are blackened and swollen. The brow and scalp are pierced with a crown of thorns. The hair is matted and filthy. His own blood is mingled with his sweat and with the spit passed upon him by the vilest and most vulgar of human beings. Early on Friday, he is led out to Calvary. And within the hour, the innocent sin-bearer has been nailed to the beams. And he hangs between earth and sky with the hatred of his people dashing up against him in great waves of sound, their taunts, their laughter, and their curses beating against his heart like hammer blows from which there is no escape. He looks up at the leaden skies. He looks down at the milling mob. He sees the soldiers, their hands still bloody from the driving of the spikes, gambling with dice for his clothing. He sees his own people, the sons and daughters of Abraham, frightfully misled by false and wicked leaders, shouting their hatred and contempt. And he opens his mouth to speak. But what does he say? Does he curse these soldiers who had begun his torture? Does he rebuke his people for their ignorance? Is he bitter, resentful? Does he want revenge? No. His words almost take us by surprise. For far from anything we might expect, he asks his Father to have mercy on those below. Maybe that's what we should expect from this sinless Son of God. For after all, it's this same mercy with which he assures us daily that we have our Father's forgiveness. We have come to know so dearly the mercy and compassion which made Jesus cry out, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do."
the second word. There were several methods of crucifixion, just as there were several kinds of crosses. The cross, for example, was sometimes fashioned in the shape of an X, and sometimes in the shape of a capital T. Most often, it was the type of cross we see in our customary crucifix, with a projection above the crossbar to carry the parchment superscription, which declared to every spectator the nature of the victim's crime. When they came to Golgotha that gloomy Friday morning, there were three men to be crucified, Jesus and two criminals. One, Jesus, was guilty of nothing. The others, guilty of crimes warranting the worst punishment the state could offer. With mingled emotions, they must have watched one another as each, in turn, submitted to the ordeal of crucifixion. Two of them were crucified, I venture to say, by the brute force of the soldiers, who labored with might and main to hold them down. Once the nails had pierced the unwilling flesh and shattered the bone, they lay still, numbed by the shock of it, almost unconscious as they were lifted up and the cross beams with pegs and ropes were put into place. The third, however, submitted quietly, with a dignity that made them wonder, in silent agony that aroused in the hearts of those hardened soldiers an unwitting admiration. It was after this execution had begun that the two criminals, not nearly so weak as Jesus, because they had not nearly suffered so much, began a strange conversation, both of them at first reviling this man who had the place of honor between them. One of them, particularly, cursing him with a vehemence that was born of bitter rebellion and unbearable pain. But the other, after watching a while, soon changed his mood, rebuked his blasphemous companion, and in faith said to the man upon the central cross, "Lord, remember me when you enter into your kingdom." With the dignity and the majesty of a mighty king, tempered by the warmth and kindness of godly love, Jesus comforted him. He promised this criminal that his horrible suffering would not only soon be over, but that this, his last day on earth, would also be his first day in heaven. He told him paradise awaited him. Jesus held up to this dying man the vision of the Garden of Eden restored, a scene of beauty, innocence, and peace, where the stain and defilement of sin was absent, and a new and perfect life would begin. We hear Jesus fling open the doors of heaven when he says to the criminal next to him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise."
Thank you.
third word. A small group of Jesus' friends, mostly women, braved the scorn and ridicule and remained at Calvary on that dark Good Friday. 3 hours before Jesus' death, a number of them, including the beloved disciple John and 3 or 4 women, approached the cross to linger there a while. Most of his disciples had taken offense at their master and had gone into hiding. Only John was not afraid of exposing himself to ridicule and danger by being near to Jesus on Calvary. That same love he felt for his master, he showed to Jesus' mother Mary, who stood near the cross too, by standing with her, supporting and comforting her. Perhaps Mary recalled when back in the temple she carried in her arms the precious child whom she above all others knew to be a unique and wonderful gift of God. Perhaps beneath the cross now she heard again the words of Simeon, words that she had never forgotten, words which had burned themselves into her memory. This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too. Now she began to understand. There it was, the sign that is spoken against, the uplifted cross. And to it they had nailed the child become man, this son of hers, who was also the son of God Most High. Here it was at last, the sword that was to pierce her soul. Now at last she knew. Jesus, seeing them there, himself unmindful of his own excruciating pain, thought of his mother and her needs and made provision for them. From that time on, John was to be like a son to Mary, someone to love and to be close to. From that time on, Mary was to be like a mother to John, someone for John also to love and take care of, as he had displayed here at the foot of the cross. You and I, too, know this same love and concern of Jesus, who similarly cares for us not only in our spiritual needs, but in our physical concerns as well. We hear Jesus care about all the needs of Mary and of us when he says from the cross, "Dear woman, here is your son," and to John, "Here is your mother."
An angel went from God to a town called Nazareth, to a woman whose name was Mary. The angel said to her, "Rejoice, O highly favored, for God is with you.
You shall bear a child, and his name shall be Jesus, the chosen one of God Most High."
And Mary said, "I am the servant of my God. I live to do your will.
My soul proclaims your greatness, O God, and my spirit rejoices in you. You have looked with love on your servant here, and blessed me all my life through. Great and mighty are you, O Holy One. Strong is your kindness evermore. How you favor the weak and lowly one.
Crucifixion. It was intended to be quite the opposite. It was, in fact, the most painful and barbaric manner of inflicting the death penalty ever devised by the unbelievable cunning and incredible cruelty of man. The agonies of crucifixion were intended to last a long time, and even the cross was so constructed as to bring about a slow and tortured death. There was, for example, a saddle-like projection which supported the body just enough to keep it from being torn down by its own weight where the nails had pierced the hands. The feet were not always spiked, but were sometimes tied to the timber with ropes. The feet of Jesus were pierced by a great rough nail. Under ordinary circumstances, the victim did not die directly from the wounds. There was at first, of course, a great loss of blood and the experience of shock. But after the clotting process had stopped the flow of blood, the blood was forced to the head and gangrene set in at the wounds. The victim became first feverish, then cold, and soon he experienced a flaming, devouring thirst from which eventually, sometimes days later, he died. Meanwhile, he could barely move because of the pain it occasioned in his wounds, and through it all, his palpitating figure was tormented by flies and by biting and crawling insects. We shudder at the mere description, but Christ experienced even greater suffering. There came a moment of darkness in Jesus' tortured and tormented soul, a moment equivalent to an entire eternity in hell. It was then that he cried to his God who had forsaken him. But no longer did Jesus address God in heaven as his Father, but as a righteous God demanding payment for sins. In the agony of Gethsemane, so intense that his sweat was as great drops of blood, his prayer still was, "O my Father." Likewise, he addressed him as Father in the first word from the cross as well as in the last. But this moment was different. At this moment, Jesus fulfilled what was said of him, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. At this moment, he was utterly forsaken and abandoned by God. At this moment, as he suffered the very pangs of hell, there was no Father to whom he could look, but only a righteous and stern God. This suffering was infinitely more intense than we can ever imagine. Only one who had been actually and completely forsaken by God could ever explain what it meant, and no human being still on this side of the grave has ever been completely forsaken by God. There is only one cause for which God ever forsakes anyone, and that cause is sin. Here we see what it meant when the Bible says that God made Christ to be sin for us. Only by being truly forsaken by God could the full price of redemption be paid. Indeed, we have been dearly bought at a tremendous price. And while we amply deserve to be forsaken by him, we now know that we need never be forsaken because of Christ, our Lord and Savior. He was forsaken in our stead. We know that it was our pain and abandonment that Jesus suffered when he cried out, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?
To see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary. He was tried by sinful men and torn and beaten, then nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath, we stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see the pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin, every bitter thought, every evil deed, crowning your blood-stained brow. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath, we stand forgiven at the cross. Now the daylight flees, now the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. Curtain torn in two, dead I raised to life, finished the victory cry. This the power of the cross. Son of God, he was slain for us. Oh, what a cost, what a love, we stand forgiven. To see my name written in the wounds, for through your suffering I am free. Death is crushed to death, and life is mine to live. One through your selfless love, this the power of the cross. Son of God, he was slain for us. Oh, what a cost! What a love we stand forgiven at the cross.
Fifth word. Jesus had gone more than 15 hours of enormous strain and torture without even a single drop of water to drink. He must have thirsted long before he came to Golgotha. On his arrival there, he had rejected the doped wine, which was offered him as a sedative. After hanging on the cross now for 6 hours, his naked body exposed to the sun, ridden with fever, emaciated, and by this time dehydrated, the thirst must have become virtually unbearable. But we want never to forget that he bore this suffering willingly for us. He could have come down from the cross as his tormentors suggested. He was the Son of God. But he didn't. In fact, he didn't even cry out vengeance against those who put him on this cross with their nails, with their rejection, with their sin. Rather, he asked forgiveness for them, and the only expression of physical need to come from his lips was this fifth word, filled with meaning for you and me, because it proves the reality of his human nature and the reality of his suffering. We know that Jesus was our real and authentic substitute. He felt the pangs of hell and suffered because of it. His body reacted from that suffering, and Jesus expressed it with these words, "I thirst."
Thank you.
the sixth word. For some hours now, the suffering sin bearer has been hanging on the cross. His only cry of physical pain in all those bitter hours has been answered. Matthew writes, "And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with vinegar, and put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink." It was the same sour beverage which was the Roman soldier's daily ration. And for a while it brought a measure of comfort and peace to the divine soldier who was dying on the cross. Death was near now, much nearer than his friends out on the fringes imagined. Some of the crowd, disturbed by the strange, unearthly darkness which already had lingered more than an hour, were on their way home. The more calloused among them disappointed they didn't get to see his final moments. Others went home shaking their heads, strangely disturbed with an uneasy feeling that something was terribly wrong. They couldn't put their finger on it. This was no ordinary crucifixion. But others stayed. They heard Jesus speak once again. What they heard wasn't the gasp of a man breathing his last as they expected, but rather a shout of victory. While his enemies were gloating over his apparent defeat, his shout of triumph came forth like the mighty cry of victory, a cry that said salvation was won. With this greatest single word ever uttered, Jesus announced the consummation of the assignment given him by the Father. Finished now was his redemptive work, the work of reconciliation and atonement. Finished was his time of humility. Soon glory and honor would be given him on high. The dominion and power of the prince of hell had been broken, and Satan had been crushed under his heel. Paradise lost had become paradise regained. What meaning these last words have for us. No longer need we look to ourselves wondering what we must do to get back into the good graces of God. No longer need we worry that our lives aren't pure enough and that when judgment comes we will be handed over to hell. All that was necessary for our forgiveness had been taken care of when Jesus said those words, "It is finished."
Holy Jesus, how hast thou offended that man to judge thee hath in hate pretended by foes derided, by thine own rejected? O most afflicted,
who was the guilty? Who brought this upon thee? Alas, my treason, Jesus hath undone thee. 'Twas I, Lord Jesus, I it was denied thee. I crucified thee.
For me, kind Jesus, was thy incarnation. Since I cannot pay thee, I do adore thee, and will ever pray thee. Think on thy pity and thy love unswerving. Not my deserving.
The seventh word. It is finished. It was a cry that went down into hell. It was a cry that rose into the very courts of heaven. It was a cry that proclaimed victory over sin, death, and hell. Just one thing more. He is about to breathe his last, and his breath is very labored now. For a moment, he is very still, and some looking up think he is dead, but not yet. For a while, there is silence. The crowd is watching, and even the worst among them are still. The silence is penetrating. It makes them shiver. It makes them wonder. There is only the sputter of the torches that the soldiers have lighted to illuminate the ghastly scene. And for those who are close enough, the steady dripping of the blood. Look, he moves. The head is lifting. He seems once more to be summoning his remaining strength. It was the hour of the evening sacrifice at the temple when his last words rang out, and these were the words that commended himself to his Father. He was confident that in death his Father would watch out for him. By this prayer, Jesus indicates that he would calmly and peacefully fall asleep, confident of his imminent resurrection on Easter morning. Death was always the last fulfillment of the law for Jesus, but it would not be his end. He would be kept safe in his Father's hand. Therefore, with confidence and boldness, his body heaves as Jesus calls out from the cross, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." His body sags, the head falls forward, the Son of God is dead. The light of the world is extinguished in death, but fortunately, we all know that the scripture does not end there. St. John writes, "The light shines and the darkness has not overcome it." We light this resurrection candle because we know that Jesus rose on Easter morning. What we are saying is that no Christian in this world ever need remain in sadness, even on Good Friday, because no Christian can forget that the Lord who died for us that first Good Friday also rose triumphant over sin in the grave on Easter Sunday. Go home this evening knowing that your Lord loved you more than you can ever imagine, and his death showed it, and live every day of your life, even today, in the triumph and joy of Easter.